this morning, or morning here in the Pacific Northwest. I'm here with the cast of Stunt Life, the movie. So please introduce yourselves. Campbell.
Hi, I'm Campbell, the director and writer of Stunt Life.
Excellent.
I'm Tania, I play JJ.
Excellent.
Actress. For my sins. All for my sins.
And Robin, do you want to go ahead?
Sorry. And I'm Robin, and I'm an actress, and I play Elle.
Excellent. Yay, so let's start with, and I guess the obvious question, this is the example, why Stunt Life, and what was the motivation behind the story and behind making that a movie?
Stud Life started off with a love for London and showing the London that's very often not seen in cinema or even TV, which is a multicultural, multigendered, multisexual orientation. It's a mad place. It's a very inclusive, wonderful place. And it stands as an island in the whole of the UK in a way. You know, people describe themselves as Londoners. That was one of the main reasons behind the film. And also, I wanted to have a film about friendship between two often groups that are considered opposing, which is the white gay man and the black stud lesbian. And that's because those groups exist, those friendships exist, but we never see them on cinema. And lastly, because I wanted to show a masculine of center woman in the center of the frame, starring in having a leading role in the movie.
Right. So then I'll ask a couple of questions as to touch on what you just said. So you're currently in London now, right? You and Tania. Robin, you're not. So that's a question about your experiences in London and how they're reflected and how they're different from what's in the movie. And then two, how much of the movie actually reflects, Campbell, your life and the lives of Robin and Tania?
The movie doesn't actually reflect my life. It's based on observations. The only thing that could be exactly about my life is a toilet scene. And this is an experience for a lot of masculine or center people when we enter what has been assigned as a safe woman-only space. We're very often policed by other women who are scared because what they see is a man, and with me, they see a black man. So that heightens the fear even more. But that's the only thing that I would say that's from my own experience. The rest is just from observation, watching people, you know, in London, people I know, people I don't even know, just by seeing them on the club scene. It's entirely an imaginary concept, even though many people have found it related to their lives. That's because I am quite good at showing what people's lives are.
I love that bathroom scene. And I love JJ's response. So didn't get mad. She's like, boom, I belong here. So Tania, how was it playing that scene? Because a lot of stuff happened in that bathroom.
Yeah. A lot of stuff happened in that bathroom. My God, that bathroom was like Piccadilly Circus, right. Man. It was like Hampstead Heath. Well, Hampstead Heath, yeah.
That scene was a lot of fun to do. I mean, it was edited a little bit because she doesn't just kind of say become a female, what we're exposing her. You know, she kind of then goes on further in the non-edited version of, you know, unzipping her trousers or what have you. So that was cute. That was fun.
Excellent. And then so Robin, and then your character Elle is also in that bathroom scene. She's kind of trying to figure out what's going on with JJ. She hasn't called after the first meeting. What was your take on that scene?
Well, I think Elle is not used to someone not calling her right away after she gives her number out. So I think that was about power, really. She comes in there and she, at first, I think, feels like she doesn't have the upper hand anymore, and then she takes the power back because that's the position she likes to be in the initial part of a relationship. I think she likes to feel that she's in control. which is a complete lie because she's never in control, really. So,
that illusion. So that kind of takes us back. So Campbell, as you wrote this script, and Tania and Robin, as you played parts in the script, how were you inspired by past, you know, lesbian movies and media? So I was thinking, like, oh, there's some parallels to Watermelon Woman. There are a lot of parallels to the book Stone Butch Blues. And I was like, are those parallels I'm just pulling because that's media I'm familiar with, or was that intentional?
Are you talking about how inspired the film was by other films?
Yes, if it was.
Well, Watermelon Woman is an iconic film. I mean, it was the first black lesbian film ever made, feature film ever made. And so it's gone down in history. And I'm inspired by Cheryl's play with form and content. Like, she mixes documentary and fictionalized efforts in her films, and so do I as well. And I also wanted to make something that was quick to do. We shot it in 10 days, which is like phenomenal. Quick to do in that limited amount of time, but telling a story. And why I wanted to make JJ a photographer, as you mentioned, in Stranger Inside, you know, one of the leads is a photographer, one of the women in the prison. I think photography allows us to document and access ourselves in a way to write ourselves into history. And what I did was I used Della Grace Volcano, who's an iconic transgender photographer. It's his images that we see of the wedding.
I didn't know
in
that.
Order to write his work back in history as well. So he's taken the images that are the wedding photos, but in the film, the images on the wall are actually Della Grace Volcano's images as well. So it's like a double play on, we're here, don't forget us, never forget us, we have a legacy.
Right, and I'm glad you brought that up, because that is a question I had while I was watching the movie. Is there significance on the other images on the wall as JJ is recording their YouTube video? So
the other images on the wall. Yeah, and it's important because Del uses people from the queer community in his photos, and obviously we've got professional actors here, but I mixed it up. I mixed the film up with also using queer iconic figures in London in the movie as well. So that leaves its legacy too, and people recognize their friends internationally when they see them. People have recognized a DJ who's Australian, you know, there's a writer, Stella Duffy, in there, Julie McNamara, there, you know, Laszlo Perlman, so they're all these kind of performers who are part of the film as well.
And
you will see other Celesbians or Celes trans people in the film, you know.
And so then I extend that question out to Robin and Tania. So as you acted your roles, how did you anchor to kind of past queer icons? And how did you further, like, as you acted out the parts, how did you begin to develop, you know, lesbian icons? Does that make sense? Can you hear me?
I don't know if this is going to get me in trouble with Campbell. I didn't even think of lesbian icons or anything like that. I just thought of Elle and who she was and what she wanted, and JJ and how she felt about JJ and how she felt about her own life and what she did for a living and how other, you know, that I was just immersed in what and who Elle was and what Elle wanted.
Right.
So I didn't even think of anything like that, actually.
You don't have to, because you're an actor. And I'm glad that that's all you thought of, in a way, because you brought that to the role.
Right. That is true. Like, Elle is a very intense character. And then, Tania, for you and JJ? So did you reference any historical queer icons, or were you thinking about how you were constructing future queer icons as you acted the part of JJ?
Can you say that again? Because we didn't quite get that.
Sorry. So the question is for Tania. So as you acted the role of JJ, were there any queer historical figures that you kind of referenced mentally as you acted that part?
Okay. Similar to Robin, no. And I think with any kind of piece, I just looked at it as a character and approached it. You know, who is JJ, what's her world, where's she come from, and it's her backstory. And there wasn't anybody, I mean, like Campbell was saying that you observe people. So I would observe people, I went to clubs and I observed people, but there wasn't kind of any one person that she was kind of based on, where I drew inspiration from in terms of an icon.
Right, excellent. And so that brings us to the next, you know, set of questions on playing a role that's not based off of personal experience, and that's more based off of research. So I'll start with Robin again. So Elle is a dominatrix, which I'll put in the larger category of a sex worker, if you feel that's correct. So how did you research playing that part for Studline?
Well, I read a lot online. And I spoke to people, and I was in contact with a dominatrix via email. And we emailed a couple of times, and I asked a few questions, and that's how, really. And I mean, it's Elle is so. I mean, Campbell and Tania know me. It's so far outside of who I am. It's not just the dominatrix. She's a very, very sexually confident woman, and she's a lesbian. So all of these things are like the opposite of me. But just through talking, and actually, and Tania as well, talking so much with Tania, she helped me a lot through especially the sexual freeness and confidence that Elle has. I think there's a lot of talking with those two amazing women about that helped me to get out of my shell and to find her.
Right. Excellent. So what was the biggest nugget, like when you were researching the role, like the dominatrix aspect of Elle's character, what was the biggest surprise? Like you were like, oh, I would have never thought about that, and that was your biggest insight via the piece?
I actually didn't realize that there was no sex. Most don't actually have sex. It's literally providing the service of dominating that person, because that is what that person wants, needs, and it's a very different. It's not. It's so not sexual.
Right.
That was what was surprising. The person who's actually doing the dominating.
Right. Right. And Yeah, and I find that very interesting. And I think the biggest line for me out of that scene was when Elle says, I learned pretty quickly that I can make more money using my body than I can with my mind. And it was insightful, but I also found it pretty sad. So how was that for you playing that character? And Campbell, what were you thinking when you wrote that?
Well, I was thinking... that's a line I wrote because what I've noticed now in the kind of, I guess it's a pornification of society, but also in the way how women's sexuality is appropriated for capital, in a way, rather than appropriated for their own power. So you'll find women get a lot more money for selling their bodies, either, you know, a singer who will show her tits, or somebody who will sell sex to guys through prostitution, than actually if she used her mind. You know, women's intellect is never valued as much as, you know, her genitalia. And I think we have to look at that, not to say our genitalia is invaluable, but that's the only thing. Our sexuality, our sex, our bodies, that's what's, you know, ultimately there's a price to pay, and, you know, people can pay for it and get it. You know, it was a comment on that in a way. When do we get valued for our minds?
Right, right. And so, yeah, for me, that was a very, especially as a femme-identified person, that was like, wow. And I guess for me, that was never my construction, right? So to see Elle's character kind of struggle with that. So then I'll switch it over.
Sorry, I'm so, just to like, I just want to, like, I don't think, just in response to that as well, that Elle was struggling with it. I think she was very, I know she says, I knew I could make more money using my body than my mind, but she's using her mind in that sense, because she's going, you know what, I'm going to take control over this. I know that I can make money this way, and I have no problem with that. This is what I do. This is how I make my money. I'm not ashamed of it. I'm proud of who I am, and that's part of the breakup. Because she's like, this is who I am. If you can't accept that, then that's
I'm not. Yeah. And you know, just to add, I think a lot of times we have to remember that the areas where initially a lot of gay clubs were red light areas. Our communities are quite close. You know, sex workers and lesbians were lovers and close back in the day. You know, when there was Stonewall, it wasn't, you know, Mr. and Mrs. Lawyer, Doctor, who were fighting for our rights in the riot. It was transgendered people, people of color, sex workers. Those people that are considered low life, still are, were the ones at the forefront of fighting, you know, forefront of actually fighting, physically fighting for our rights. So, you know, having a sex worker in the film was also about paying homage to people who are often ignored and you know, we're snide about now, but, you know, they embraced us before other people did.
Right. I think that's great context to provide. So I'm glad that you had that discussion, right? So that's great insight. So then I'll switch to Tania and playing the role of JJ, which JJ is a very masculine center person. Tania, you appear not to be, so can you elaborate on that?
That was interesting, as Robin will tell you. So I guess the first point of call was to, you know, understand who she was, blah, blah, blah. And then to find her, I always start, when I look at a character, I always kind of start with her body, you know, her physicality, and my and JJ's are very different. So we rehearsed a lot, and we spoke a lot, and that, you know, gave me kind of a clear path. But then came the ultimate transformation, and Campbell said to me, go and get a boy's haircut, so I did. And that was the first point,
go and get it, more boys.
And then she said, no, it's still not masculine enough, go and get it again, so I did. And this happened maybe thrice or four times, until it was perfect. And then, you know, it didn't go with my wardrobe, so I kind of, and I wanted to embrace her world and her body in any case, so I binded, and I borrowed some clothes, and I took some clothes to a wardrobe and what have you. And I remember putting on the clothes and looking in the mirror, and I jumped back, and I hid, you know, I hid out of the mirror, and then I kind of, you know, I just peered in to see, oh my God, who is that? And she was totally different to me.
Right.
And then I went out on the street, public saw me as a young black boy, and that was really interesting because the London that you speak of, that we so fondly, or I so fondly love, became really isolating and a bit mean. It was a bit mean to the young black boy that I was. And after 3 days, I started getting really pissed off, you know, to people's responses, because women, I don't know, I'd get budged and bugged. I was either ignored or feared. Those were the two responses that I got. So after about 3 days of it and getting really worked up, excuse me, I decided that I can't carry on and walk around with all this angst in my body. So I decided that I would be a gentleman, you know, and just be courteous and but it takes a lot of work. because you have to kind of second guess what people's reactions are going to be. You see it coming and you get in there first to be that beautiful gentleman that says, you know what, don't barge me, I will just allow you to kind of walk past and make a thing of it, as it were. So yeah, JJ's experience in the world was very alienating. But it was fun as well, though. Sorry, yeah. It was really fun because I got to be kind of cheeky in a youthful right. way that I haven't done for a while.
But also,
you go, Cam.
No, I'm just going to say, very often when you have people of color in movies or movies that are LGBT, people think that you're using amateurs. And what I really wanted to do was to use professional actors, because professional actors bring a nuance to roles in a way that I think, if you have the experience but are not a professional actor, you can't bring. And you know, it's to Nia's and Robin's credit that they came out of their own personal experience to take the risk to do these roles as women of color. Because a lot of times, actresses who are women of color very, very rarely take risky roles, or what's considered risky roles.
Right.
And so, you know, I felt blessed to have them on the shoot, but also to have their wonderful performances in the film. That, you know, it really kind of gave the film some meat, I thought.
And I
100% agree with that. And just to go back to the role of JJ, the acting was very convincing, downright to the body movement and the mannerisms. So, did you study?
It should win awards, man.
I would give that a stud. Like, that is very convincing. Because I know there are times when I'm like, you know what, tonight I'm going to dress up. I'm going to do the whole stud thing. And then by the time I actually go out, I end up in a dress and heels. it's not just putting on clothes. It's a movement and it's a mindset.
Yeah, exactly. It's not just the clothes.
Right. Tania, who did you model yourself after? Who were you constructing in your mind? Was it your father?
Sorry.
One more time.
I'm so sorry. I didn't quite catch the last bit. Who did I?
Yeah. So who did you? Was there a particular person that you modeled your movements and your mannerisms?
Oh, my movements or whatever.
Everything.
Oh, everything. Okay. No, not one particular person. I kind of went into the clubs, and it's there in the script, I think. You know, it Campbell does this great thing. She really writes characters quite well. So the clues are all there in terms of where she's thinking, where she's at. And we rehearsed a lot. Well, I say a lot. We rehearsed every 2 weeks, but we had this dialogue where I understood exactly what Campbell wanted. So by the time we got to filming it, we were able to execute it with one take, you know, because I think maybe on two scenes only, we got to do two takes. So it wasn't one person. I did look at, you know, young black boys, because obviously that's how I was perceived. But I think it was just, more so, I think it was just written. It's written there in terms of where she thinks, where she's at. And of course, she smokes a lot as well, so that would have something to do with it.
Tania also like changed so much from when, because I knew Tania before the film, and
yes.
How she started to change is somewhere in the middle of rehearsals, she was also different with me. Like, and even when we'd have like a lunch break or something, and you and I would be walking on the street, she'd always make sure that she was on the outside, so she was on the side that traffic was on. She carried my bags all the time, and that didn't happen before. You know, we were both two women, and other people should be carrying our bags. You know, so she suddenly like was really protective of me, and I felt like I had this strapping young man looking after me during the filming. It was brilliant. I loved it.
You became even off camera, it seems like.
Yeah,
because you don't leave it, you know. And at home as well, I was JJ. Like literally, she filled my world in every essence. Going to the shop, because she can be quite curt at times. I think JJ can, just very direct in her language. She doesn't.
Use coyness.
Yeah, not at all. And she's quite stringent with her words, so she just kind of, you know, it can be appear to be abrupt. So Seb, the guy who plays Seb, actor that plays Seb, we would go to the shop together, what have you, and he would apologize to me sometimes. Do you remember that, Robin?
Yeah. But it's also in a way, it's a, you know, like Robin talks about the being, what's the word, gentlemanly, but that's also another way of being a stud. Very often, studs get the reputation of being quite misogynistic or being, you know, badly behaved. And there are studs like that, obviously, people who haven't been educated in a feminist way, but there are other studs who value people around them and who behave in a respectful way and also who behave respectfully to their partners.
Right.
You know, and so that's the kind of stud that JJ was and Tania was portraying in JJ.
Excellent. Yeah, and that's definitely what I saw. When I saw Tania's portrayal of JJ, I could definitely relate to that too. That's quintessential women in my life, so I appreciate that. So when I went to screenings of Stud Life, the one comment that, like, people love the movie, it's very sexual, the soundtrack is amazing, but they were like, wow, that relationship moved really quickly. It's like, wow, is that still the first date? Like, their rings, like, have, like, so walk me through that. How did that happen in the script?
All right. Oh, okay, people got the impression it was the first date. It wasn't the first date. It was a time lapse in between when they were sort of running around London. So it was meant to be like, you know, 6 months later. And there was a line, but it was cut out because it was deemed to be too obvious. And the imagery was supposed to let you know that there was a time lapse, but it wasn't a specific time lapse, you know. Whatever time lapse is in people's minds. In my mind, it was 6 months, but, you know, there was some time. It wasn't the first day when they did the rings.
So they met at the park that afternoon after, you know, the bathroom scene, and then they go back to Al's house.
Yeah, they had sex the first date. They did.
And then
some people do, you know.
Yeah, there's no judgment there. There's absolutely no judgment there. And then, you know, in terms of becoming emotionally connected and involved in the rings, so the feedback that I tend to hear at different screens is like, wow, that happened really quickly, right? And so kind of like, do you feel like that's prevalent in lesbian relationships? Do you feel like that was just a connection between Elle and JJ in that construction of the development of their relationship?
Our thing is sort of like there's a beach ball of death. It's frozen.
Oh, okay. It was like a beach ball of death. Oh, because I can still hear you on my end.
Oh, okay. It wasn't really a comment. You know, I think lesbians do get together very, very quickly. And I think gay people do, but I think it's also a British thing. You know, we don't have a dating culture in Britain as you do in the States.
Okay.
So people hook up, you know, quite quickly and say they're in a relationship. And I think that's a particular British thing.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, living in New York, I have to say it's really different. The dating out here. Yeah.
Okay. Really. And that's good to know. Yes. In the US, so my next comment or observation is, so JJ is, sorry, can you hear me okay?
Yeah, so it's sort of, it keeps crashing, but it's okay now.
Okay, so JJ is what is currently referred to, or I currently refer to, as a touch me not stud. Describe, like, both Robin and Tania and Campbell, as you wrote it, those screens where it becomes those scenes where it becomes obvious that JJ is a touch me not stud.
Touch me not stud. That's like a phenomenon. If you just Google that on YouTube, you'll see that.
Right. So you know? I guess more like, why was JJ written as a touch me not stud, and how was it?
You don't, why? Because I think it's a. There's two things. I didn't want the sex scene to be like the sex scenes you always see in gay films, in lesbian films. You know, they always seem very smooth, unproblematic. Everybody knows what everybody's supposed to be doing. Everybody, you know, oh, you're a woman, I'm a woman, therefore we know each other. You know, I didn't want that.
because I think it's much more complicated, and sometimes it's quite awkward if you're with somebody who's very different to you. Sometimes it's bang, wonderful, sometimes it's not. And I, you know, my films, you're not going to see like unproblematic queerness. You're not going to see everybody's all fine and happy queerness. You know, you're going to see something that's a little bit more complex, a little bit layered. So the introduction of A Touch Me Not Stud shows, actually, you think you know me, but you don't. So we need to have a conversation. And so that's what that was about. We need to have a conversation. But that should happen with anybody hooking up, you know? You can't just jump into somebody and assume you know their body and assume you know their boundaries. There needs to be a discussion anyway, touch me not or not. So that's just having that, you know, it's a mechanism for having that conversation. Where is right to touch you? Where is not?
Tania, Robin, do you have anything to add to that? My favorite line from that scene is like, Elle likes to lick labia. I was like, she never leaks. Quoting that.
It's my favorite thing from the buffet.
in a way, do you know what? I want one.
No, you go.
No, what I wanted to do, and this is where Robin was fantastic in the audition, is I wanted to show active female desire for other females. And if you're feminine, a lot of times you're seen as inactive, as passive, not showing active desire, not wanting it, not demanding it. And Elle is not that kind of woman. And there are many feminine femme lesbians who are active. It doesn't mean they can't be submissive sexually, which is a different thing, because she does submit sexually to JJ, even though she's a dominatrix in her work. But people need to understand the distinction between being passive and being submissive. So she's not passive. She desires, she wants to have sex with other women. And, you know, people think because you're a feminine lesbian, you're an inauthentic lesbian. You're not real. You're always on the hunt for some guy. And that, you know, you're the one that people do things to. You don't do things to other people. So I wanted to break that right out, because to show, you know, she's strong, she knows what she wants, and she wants JJ, and she desires JJ.
And Elle is not interested in men in any way.
Yeah, I really appreciated that construction and that portrayal of a femme lesbian. So, and I appreciated the fact that Elle was very powerful.
Tania,
did you have anything to add?
No.
It's been
What's interesting, when we, because like Robin says, we're so different from our characters, and we did talk a hell of a lot about sex during this shoot, didn't we? And I think just
everybody did.
We all just, you know, it's like, I don't know you, but you know so much about me that I haven't even shared with friends.
Yeah. And I think that's
like this, because it's so tight as well. You have to build those trust things. So it was just really interesting to be. God, I'm saying too much. I'm about to say too much. But like you said, Robin, she was very different to you and myself. And this whole idea of what you can be, what you can't be, it was a real education for me. Like, I have never come across a touch of a stud before. And I generally don't like the word no in my own life anyway, so.
Right.
In any aspect of it.
Must be a success.
Okay.
And very,
because I felt like that scene between, you know, JJ and Elle, from what I've heard of the community, was very accurate. Right? So I was like, oh, that's interesting. So as we wrap up, what are some insights that you hope people take away from the movie? And that's a question to all three of you.
Good question. What are the insights we can take away about the film? You wanna do Robin?
I think the main thing is that it is a story of friendship and of love. And what I, certainly when I came to it, I wasn't thinking of, and I understand that it, obviously it's a film with a stud lesbian lead character, and it's, you know, gay characters and all of that. I do understand that, and I do understand that it's important. But the main thing is that it's a story about friendship and love. And it's a story that everyone can relate to. It's not just a lesbian story or a stud story or a gay story. It's a human story. People fall in love and have friendship that is important in their life all the time. And I've had friends who have watched the film who are gay or lesbian, and I've had friends who are straight who have watched the film, and everyone has gotten the same thing from it. It's not a story that's only for a particular person. Right. Is what I want to say about it.
Excellent.
And I think just to add to what Robin said, really, I think it was Campbell's parents who came along and watched the film. You know, so it's not just about sexuality. You know, people who identify it, it's not to say sexual orientation. It's also, you know, culturally and whatever age people kind of relate, because it is the human story. What I will say is that do look out for stuff like, because there will be more stories of Robin and JJ and Seb and Smack Jack and the L and their misdemeanors and their adventures. So hopefully that will be coming to the screen at some point soon. Maybe not the big screen, maybe the small screen, but we shall be able to kind of see their lives and what happens next for JJ and L at some time in the near future.
Yay, I'm excited.
Me too, I'm excited.
But also what I would say is it's interesting what Tania said about the cultural thing as well, which often gets kind of slipped away. You know, the film is, my parents watched it, loved it, and the thing that my mother said was, this film's about the human condition. That's what she related to. But also the scene that she liked the best was the barbershop. And in the barbershop, the woman chats in Jamaican patois. Now, you know, I wanted to introduce different voices in the film. And one of the voices that you hear in London, like on the tube, I heard this guy chatting in Jamaican, you know, he was giving the announcements, but in Jamaican patois.
Yes.
We never hear those diverse voices coming from London on cinema or TV. And in my films, I want to show that. I want to show we are London too. London is everybody and everybody is London. So if people take away people, you know, they take that away from them.
And I definitely appreciated the accents and seeing people of color in London. So, I mean, that was a very rich experience for me, because it is the default. Like, if you're doing something British or in London, that it is white. Right.
It tends to be, absolutely. You know,
and it's so not like that. London is, you can be on one bus journey, right, traveling for 10 minutes, and you hear 5 different languages, must-have accents.
Yeah.
Right, Robin?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, this is the thing that I found that was so, and why I wasn't going through any kind of major shock in that sense when I moved to New York. Because it's like that. You get on the train, and you can be in every part of the world at the same time, you know, and I hope that this kind of filmmaking as well, and what Campbell has done here, and all these different voices and cultures and colors, I hope that that becomes a phenomenon that spreads, and I just hope it continues to be like that, because it's something I have also seen in America as well. You know, there isn't a lot that's shown on television and on screen with a lot of cultural diversity. I mean, we live in a culture diverse world.
Right.
Why aren't we seeing more of that? So, you know,
absolutely. More. Yeah. And you know, the thing is, as long as when people see queer bodies or people of color bodies, they often think, oh, the film's about issues. It's issues. It's a problem. It's blah, blah, blah. Which is why I moved away from a kind of straight drama and did a comedy. Nobody is coming out in the film. Nobody's talking about, you know, they're a victim of racism.
Right.
Of course, there's a bashing, but that's kind of half of the course. But, you know, JJ's not coming out. Ellie's not ashamed. They're just
part of the madness and the craziness of London, and that we need to see more films like that with people of color. You know, we don't need to set ourselves up as emblems of anything. Just come out with our wonderful
victims. I'm so overseeing ourselves as victims when we're such a powerful set of people, you know? And like Campbell said, I don't feel like it was a black story. It's not a black film. It's just a London film.
It's London.
London. Yeah. No. Leave it was a gay film. It's just, for me, it's
a people film, which is inhabited by queers, because we don't usually inhabit what's considered people. I put us queers in the people frame to show we are human.
I mean, it's definitely a story that is relatable to a lot of people, but I know for me it was important to see queer women of color in leading roles and living their lives and having those cultural references that I could identify to, right? Mm-hmm. And that were intentional for me. So we talked about the photographic images and so forth, and how that was intentional to have a queer reference. And to me, that's very important, but that's my frame, right? Coming from that sister cinema vantage point. So it is a story that is a human story, but I personally appreciate those queer women of color references. And so talking about queer women of color references, the soundtrack, I don't know if they were queer women of color, but the soundtrack is amazing. How did you do that?
I'm an insomniac, so I was up late in the night trawling YouTube. And then we had a musical supervisor, Mick Clark, who was wonderful in getting us some of the high-end music. So I used music from queer people of color cultures, but also from people of color cultures as well, to mix it up, because I wanted to have artists who were unsigned. It's all part of my legacy thinking. Have them there, they're promoted, their names out there, their music's out there, as well as, you know, having a little bit more established music artists as well. And also to have music that is the music of clubs in London. You know, there are queer clubs in London that play that music. It's not all techno, trance, dancey stuff, you know. They are. So I wanted to show that. I know.
It's okay on its day.
It's okay, but you know, I wanted to show, like, you know, you can be a person of color and still have your own cultural references. Do you know what I mean? You don't have to perform something else and be queer.
Right. And so, that soundtrack is amazing, and I can't wait to buy it and own it. I think that was a large part of the reason why I was so excited about the film when I heard the trailer and the music accompanying the trailer. I was like, I can't wait to watch that live. And it met all my expectations. So as did this Google Hangout, it was so cool to talk with y'all about the movie. It took a lot of takes. But
we got there.
And super happy, beautiful work. I look forward to seeing more stories and continuing to work with all of y'all. It's amazing. Y'all are truly talented. Thank
you to Robin and Tania for creating wonderful roles. You created them.
Thanks for inviting us.
My pleasure. Okay, have a great day.
You too.
Bye-bye.
Bye.